So this talk is called Before the Maya, the Olmec, Quetzalcoatl, and the Megalithic Origins of Central America. And this is based on a trip I did there this year late last year. I traveled around Mexico, Guatemala, Honduras and Belize, exploring all the sites really that were before the Maya. So we're not going to look at really any Mayan stuff today, although that is what's recognized really as the main sort of hub of ancient sites in Central America. But there's a lot more to that than you might imagine. For example, there's pyramids near Mexico City that are supposed to be over 7,000 years old. There's strange statues reminiscent of those at Tiwanaku in Bolivia, which are believed now to be thousands of years old. There's huge megaliths at places like Monte Alban and Mitla around Oaxaca. And the Olmecs, who were spread along the Gulf Coast, they go back at least to 2000 BC. And they were of huge megalithic kind of structures and colossal heads that they were carving back then. Some as good, if not as better than some of the Egyptian carving. And so even the stelae at some of these Mayan sites, which are well known, they just look like megaliths, and they're just standing around at all these pyramid sites. But there's evidence now that they were around before the Maya too, and the sites were built around them. And there's obviously, as you go into Belize, there's places called Lubantu and Nimli Punit, and these are of megalithic structure as well. They're not classic pyramid sites of the Maya. And there's even the story of the crystal skull at Lubantum there as well. And when you look into this and you sort of go beyond and before the Mayan era, you find that it wasn't the Maya who even invented the so-called Mayan calendar, or the long count calendar, which is famous for its end date in 2012. What has now been realized is that the Olmecs along the Gulf Coast, about 1,500 to 2,000 BC, originated the Mayan calendar and were fully aware of the end date in 2012. So this is just some of the classic pictures of the Maya and the Aztec, which are the later cultures of that part of the world, and some of the codexes. And this is the area that I explored. It was really the central area here, which kind of interested me, going up to Mexico City. I didn't really go to the Yucatan, because I went there six or seven years ago and explored the area then. So I won't be talking about any of the Mayan sites in that area, but it's mainly from Mexico City through Oaxaca, Gulf Coast, down into southern Guatemala and Belize. And this is some of the sites just shown on here. This is Teotihuacan in Mexico City. In fact, Mexico City, before it was developed into a major, the central city in Mexico, it was actually a huge kind of lake city. And they built Tenochtitlan, which is a later Aztec site, actually within the lake and on sort of and around it. But there's a place called Quilquilco, which is just south of Mexico. You can actually get there on the subway from the center. And it's a 7,000-year-old site. And we'll be having a look at that shortly. And this is one of the most interesting datings of the sites that we get in Central America. But before that, we really need to look at the legend of Quetzalcoatl, or Quetzalcoatl, as it's sometimes pronounced, which in the Mayan tongue, or the Aztec's tongue, means the plumed serpent, or the rainbow serpent in some other traditions. And the legends around him are very interesting, because they definitely go back to the Olmec times now, they've realized. They're not early Mayan or Aztec, although the Aztecs and the Mayans both revered him as one of their gods, as their main god, in fact. And he was said as a legendary figure to have turned up on the Gulf Coast with his band of followers. He was a tall white man, as can be seen in this picture here, looking a bit like Jesus. He was bearded, he had long hair, he had flowing robes and sandals. He taught the arts of agriculture, of peaceful communication between tribes, and also he taught the arts of megalithic construction, marriage, how to grow food, and all these different higher qualities. He even said to have taught the art of writing and to develop languages that they could all understand. So he was like a really high-level kind of figure who turned up there and taught, and he's had such an influence on the cultures there that it lasted for several thousand years. Although the origins of Quetzalcoatl are still shrouded in mystery, as they don't know if he was an actual person or if it's just a legendary kind of myth that they've kind of developed it from. Although the evidence suggests that he really was a person and he did come over. Because when you look at South America, we find the exact same legends and the exact same descriptions for Viracocha, along around Lake Titicaca in Bolivia and Peru. I visited there a couple of years ago and explored all the myths and legends there, and they're still going strong today, as they are in Central America. Now, Quetzalcoatl, although he wasn't mentioned in any Olmec literature, basically because there isn't any, there's only stones left to decipher their culture from. There's in the Olmec culture, we find evidence of lots of carvings with Caucasian or white people with beards and wearing long robes. And so we have a feeling and speculation that the Olmecs were certainly, it was certainly around before then. There was actually a leader of the Toltec peoples in the 10th century, which they think it was around Tula, and he was actually called Quetzalcoatl, and the stories around him have sort of been copied from the older myths, and it's kind of got mixed up, because now everyone believes Quetzalcoatl was just this 10th century Toltec king, which they realize now that can't be the case, because the legends definitely go way back before then. So I just wanted to introduce you to Quetzalcoatl, and then we'll look at him and we'll see evidence of him in other sites as we move through the different areas of Central America. In Tepoztlan, which is just south, 60 miles south of Mexico City, this is the temple of Quetzalcoatl, and it's said to have been his birthplace. Now we think, and the researchers and archaeologists think, this was actually the 10th century Quetzalcoatl. But I just wanted to show you this, because this is the most amazing town. It's like the Glastonbury of Mexico. It's the hippie town, it's the artist town. It's a town where all the alternative thinkers live. I spent a few days here and had a beautiful time there. And you have to walk all the way up this kind of whole hilltop mountain to get to the small pyramid temple up there. So this is said to be the birthplace, and he was born there some 1,200 years ago, according to legend. So if we move slightly, I think, southwest of Mexico City, but still in the confines of Mexico City, El Cuicuilco, which is a very strange circular pyramid, which is interesting me, because the lava flow that was said to have been discovered over it was analyzed by carbon dating, and the first test they did on it back in the 1920s, I think, was said to be over 7,000 years old. And so this kind of threw all the archaeologists and the Mayanists into chaos, and they couldn't cope with this kind of dating. So they retested it, and even the retest they did several years later, it still went to 2000 BC. But even now, Quilquilco is only recognized as being about 10 AD, still in the sort of early Mayan era. And so there's a big problem with that, because they basically just fixing their dates as they see fit to fit in with the current paradigm. And this dating kind of problem, it happens throughout Central America, as it does probably throughout the world, as we will probably see at this conference. And so this really intrigued me, because if you look on the left here, there's this strange little symbol, which you've probably seen at Newgrange, and you've probably seen in other places. Even at Tiwanaku in Bolivia, this symbol is I've photographed it there. It's found all around the world, and according to some people, it's related to telluric energies. Others say it's related to the way the sun moves and the shadow of a stick moves through archaeoastronomy. It creates this kind of shape. So this is found in so many places around the world that it just intrigued me that it was found at Quilquilco, potentially the oldest site in Central America. In fact, when the archaeologists first opened up Quilquilco, they saw a blue light appear above the pyramid. And they got all excited, because they thought they may find treasure there. So they dug in, ruined the whole thing, and there was nothing there, unfortunately, for them. So the next, one of the other places we visited was Tula. And there's just a couple of interesting things here that grabbed me. The fact that these are images of what looks like Quetzalcoatl, not really with the beard, but certainly with the feathers and the plumes. And these look remarkably similar to the structure, to the statues in Tiwanaku in Bolivia, as you can see here. The similarities are quite incredible, and they're pretty much the same size, same kind of construction, same kind of stonework. And we'll find more similarities with South America as we move through this talk. These strange things, very interesting, said to be incense bags, but if you look carefully, they look more like plasma guns, if you know what they are. In Toltec legend, there's this word, which I can't pronounce, but it translates as fire serpents. And this is what Graham Hancock mentioned in Fingerprint of the Gods as well, is that it was something, as a legend, said they could cut through people's bodies with it, and it was used for decapitation, which is nice. But also, it was they think it could have been powerful enough to use to cut and shape and carve stone. And this may have been the technique that the ancients were using in this part of the world. And there's a lot of unusual kind of stories about that that I've sort of discovered that kind of back this theory up. And this is on the back, you know, this is on the back part. It's kind of on the back part, sort of around here, around the belly button kind of area. You get this strange face as well. And just outside the front of Tula is a very interesting selection of what looks like megaliths. And this kind of, you know, got me, being a megalithomaniac, and it just looked like a sort of remnants of a stone circle. I mean, if we found this in England, it would be registered and recorded as a stone circle. We'll probably get on OS maps. But because it's just outside the front in the car park at Tula, it doesn't get that kind of recognition. And all the pyramid sites and the Toltec statues take the credit. But if you look, you know, I took quite a few photos of this, and it just looked like it was the remnants of a stone circle. And so this intrigued me immediately, because I'd heard stories that perhaps some of these sites were originally megalithic sites that were then developed later into pyramid sites and later Mayan sites. So we'll see more of this kind of evidence as we move through this talk. In Teotihuacan, I'm just going to quickly have a look at this. This isn't a Mayan site. They're not sure who even lived there, who even built it. There's a real mystery shrouded around that. The dating on it's a bit controversial. Some people say it's many thousands of years old. The archaeologists say it's like 1,000 or 1,500 years old, depending on who you ask. But at the end of the lane, going down the main lane at Teotihuacan, is the pyramid of Quetzalcoatl, which intrigued me, because you can see, again, the plumed serpent here, and also here, a close-up photo of some of the structures around it. And right in the middle of the whole complex at Teotihuacan, just over this is the pyramid of the moon in the background. In front of it, which no one has mentioned, I've never seen a photograph of it, is a huge monolith. And it's virtually in the centre of that area around the moon pyramid and near the sun pyramid, and all the temples and smaller temples are built around it. And so why that hasn't been noticed, I'm not sure. But they put a little fence around it, so they must have thought it had some importance. And here as well, this is what looks like an Olmec face, or an Olmec jade mask that was in the museum at Teotihuacan. And there's suggestions that the Olmecs may have even been responsible for the construction of Teotihuacan. But that's just speculation at the moment, as there's no evidence. It's just a view from the pyramid of the moon, looking over to the pyramid of the sun, and there's me sitting there. And you can see how, you know, this happens a lot in megalithic sites, but also at pyramid sites around the world, how the shapes of the hill seem to sort of mirror the shape of the actual structures themselves. And it's just down here, just past there, is where that megalith is that we just looked at in the previous slide. So there's a lot to say about Teotihuacan. There's underground tunnels going under the Pyramid of the Sun. There's a few megaliths along the side of the Pyramid of the Sun here. There's a lot of strange stories. The placement of it in relation to other sites in Mexico is very interesting, which I'm happy to chat with people about afterwards. It's quite complicated. A geodetic survey that seemed to be done over Central America in prehistory. But the next site we went to look at is Cholula, which surprisingly for many people find this quite shocking when they're told this. This is actually the largest pyramid ever built in the world. And you can see that it's pretty big. This is just the sort of front bit here. And these are people here. You can see the sheer size. And it looked all like this all the way around, apparently. It's a huge, great thing. But the problem with this one is that when Hernan Cortes and his band of followers turned up in 1519 to pretty much behead the Aztec Empire, they came to Cholula, and this was a site dedicated to Quetzalcoatl. It was actually built in his honour, according to legend. And it's 45 acres, has a height of 210 feet. It's about three times the size of the Giza Pyramid, and about twice the size of the Bosnian Pyramid. And so we're looking at quite a big structure, and the sheer man hours it must have taken to construct such a pyramid is not even worth considering. But again, there's evidence that the Olmecs were here as well. So we're looking at a potential Olmec site here. This is a strange kind of Olmec-oid head, which is around one side of the pyramid. We've got these megaliths just popping up everywhere, and there's this kind of face. So as we get into the Gulf area, we'll still see lots of these Olmec heads, 17 of them in total. But because Hernán Cortés turned up, the same similar thing happened in South America. All the people there believed he was the return of Quetzalcoatl. He was a white man with a beard, a band of followers. He came at the same year, Quetzalcoatl promised to come back in, and all these kind of things. So they greeted him like he was their god, and he got treated as such. So he took huge advantage of that and managed to overthrow the whole Aztec Empire within a decade. And so we see that these legends were strong then. You know, even up to the 1500s, the legends of Quetzalcoatl were still very strong, and they were still reminiscent throughout the many years of history before that. Also at Cholula, we have this very strange megalith outside the front of the main steps we looked at previously, and you can see it's got a sort of, this bit here is a little bit like Stonehenge to me. Also, it's got a hole in it, perfectly cut. Reminds me of the stonework in Peru and Bolivia. I mean, this is just standing here. It doesn't have any fitting with the rest of the structure. But again, it's evidence of a potential megalithic kind of culture that were there before the Toltecs, the Maya, and the other cultures. This just shows you a picture from the museum, the complete sort of structure and how big it was. This is an old wood carving. If you head further east, out of Mexico City towards Oaxaca, just before you reach Oaxaca, you reach a place called Monte Alban. And this is a fascinating place. It's a Zapotec site, and they were around before the Maya, maybe 500 BC. The official dating of this site is 500 BC, but there's evidence that there was stuff going on there much, much earlier. And we can see this huge megalith here. It was an astronomical megalith that measured the sort of sun's zenith over that latitude of Central America, and it's been tested and recorded, and it does work as such. These are the strange kind of dancers that the archaeologists call these megaliths that are around the back end of the site. And we'll just have a look at some of those, because strangely, these look like Olmecs, because as we'll find out shortly, the Olmecs were said to be of Negroid origin, of African origin, a very sort of Nubian or Western African faces, which has caused a big problem for the Mayanists and the archaeologists. And we see that here at Monte Alban. But also on some of these carvings, we see what appears to be white people with beards, which doesn't make any sense, because no one in Central America, or the natives especially, they don't grow facial hair. And so we're looking at from up from 500 BC potentially to 1500 BC, a culture with beards, which must have travelled and come into that country from another place. And you can see these structures that were built by the later Zapotecs incorporated these stones into their structures. And if you go to the site itself, you can see that some of these kind of things here are actually placed in the corners of the later Zapotec pyramids. So although that isn't mentioned in any of the official literature on the site or in any of the archaeology books, you go there for yourself and you can see it with your own eyes. As you head out to the car park, you find this huge megalithic trilithon, which isn't even mentioned. Again, it's a bit like the little stone circle outside of Tula. You can see the size of this. I mean, I stood to about that height there. And so we're looking at something not as big as Stonehenge, but certainly as impressive when you compare it to other megalithic sites in Central America. This is like one solid block. That's a solid block. And there's two more of these around the other side as well. And this is just in the back of the car park. So I thought I'd make a big deal of it, even if they don't. But if you head through Oaxaca and carry on heading east, you get to a place called Mitla, which has a very similar kind of megalithic lintel structure. And the underlying structure of this whole site is remarkable. It's famous for its mosaic stonework, which we'll have a look at in a moment. But it's these here which really interested me, because there's probably about 30 of these sort of lintels over doorways. And mostly these, not necessarily on this one, but mostly these are solid chunks of stone as well. And then we get these huge megalithic columns, you know, carved out of solid basalt, and these come from 12 miles away, and the quarry's already been found. So we know that they knew how to construct in a megalithic way. So whether that was one of the arts and sciences that Quetzalcoatl and his followers brought over, and it's still there because these are such large megalithic structures, and then later the Mayans, the Zapotecs, and the Toltecs developed and built over that, that's the speculation, that's the theory that I'm trying to sort of piece together. These are some other photos from Mitla. We can see here the megalithic columns is another area. This is the main temple area. although it's clearly stated by archaeologists that there are no columns in Central America, you can see them quite clearly there. I can see them. I went there. These are the famous mosaics that are throughout. There's quite a few of these in Mitla. It's very famous for that. The Zapotecs were incredible stonemasons. This just shows you the sort of size of the stone that just fell over that we're talking about. I thought I'd get a photo of a little girl standing there to make it look even bigger. And this is the main temple area, which these are within, and that is within. It's definitely worth a visit, Mitla. It's an incredible site. It's beautiful energy there as well, and you could spend a whole day there. Driving back in my little tuk-tuk down the road, basically a bike with a sort of seat on the back, driving back to the bus stop, I spotted this. I looked over a wall and suddenly there was a whole megalithic temple there. It's just derelict and there was kids playing football in it, which kind of interested me because you can see the sort of shaping of the stone to fit them together. Can't really see it on the back ones, but there. I noticed that on a few of these stones. So we're looking at sort of Tiwanaku, Bolivia-style stonework, Stonehenge-style stonework. This is back in the main Mitla site. It just shows you the size of the lintels. There's a sort of slightly fisheye lens that caused that illusion. It's actually flat and straight. And the beautiful cut stonework, there's no mortar. It's perfectly pieced together like you get in Central, like you get in South America. Now we're going to move swiftly into the Gulf area region, the Gulf of Mexico. It's all this region here we're looking at, and we're going to move into the Olmec sites from Mitla there. I sort of went north, well, after spending a few days on the beach down there, of course, then went up north here to the Olmec sites. First of all, I went to Jalapa Museum, which is just in just north of Veracruz City, and these are two of the major Olmec heads. You've probably seen these in photographs and books and things before. 17 of these have been discovered in total. They've got about, I think, 9 or 10 on display at Jalapa Museum. Some people say they look a bit like me, but I don't really want to comment on that. And there's another one that's in the garden. I'm just going to have to flick through this because there's a lot of photos I took, so I'm going to move quite swiftly. But you can see the clearly negroid features, big lips, wide nose, chubby face, funny helmet as well. But this happens through every single one of these Olmec heads is like that. They're all frowning as well. So this is why they say it looks like me. This is one that's nearly smiling. It's getting there. But you can see, again, this looks like it's been deliberately damaged. This is something that happened with a lot of these Olmec heads. They were deliberately damaged at a later period. Because these basically date from 1500 BC to 1800 BC. Most of the ones here were found at San Lorenzo. Some were found at La Venta, but we'll look at the La Venta ones soon. Some were at Tres Zapotes, and there's a few other sites. It's mainly San Lorenzo was like the capital. And on the back here, you get these strange 7 feathers. To me, they're a symbol of Quetzalcoatl. Here's some more heads. This one's completely battered. This one's actually smiling. It's the only one out of 17. So this one's not smiling so much. He's been quite destroyed. But again, you can see the features. Clearly, that's not native Central American. And these are the 17 heads that have been discovered. This one we'll look at shortly. This is the biggest one. It's the 40-ton one. And it's known that these were moved about 10 to 15 miles from the mountains at the south of San Lorenzo, the ones from San Lorenzo anyway. And they've got no idea how they moved. And there was a hilarious BBC documentary that went over to this area to try and move an equally large piece of basalt from the mountains there using primitive techniques. And another guy trying to carve one of these heads using the tools that they would have used then. And it was the most enjoyable program I've ever seen, and how they failed so miserably to even move a stone a few yards and with 100 people. They ended up using cranes. And how they couldn't carve the stone from this sort of top college professor. And he was so humiliated, he went home halfway through the program. So that's what I might have to show that another year. It's thoroughly enjoyable. And this is, again, this is Jalapa Museum. This is some of the classic stonework you get of the Olmecs. You get this crouched position. This comes up a lot. You get these huge altars, which are kind of this big, maybe 10 feet wide. Solid basalt again, carved beautifully. This is obviously worn. And these strange zoomorph, anamorph figures, crouched Egyptian-looking childlike figure. These keep turning up. And we get the elongated skull. This is actually from Jalapa Museum. And this is the same thing as we saw yesterday. That this is one from Nazca that I took a couple of years ago. And so we're seeing the same kind of elongated skull kind of culture in Central America as you get into South America. And so again, we're seeing the connections keep turning up. There's a suggestion that the Olmecs were either met, they actually went down to South America through the whole of Central America and actually met up with these people to learn the techniques. But this is, again, this is just speculation. This is the strange turtle. I just really liked him, so I thought I'd show you that. So we move now slightly further east from Jalapa, past Veracruz town, to a place called Santiago Tuxtla. And in the plaza there, we have this head. This is the biggest one they've ever found. It's 40 tons. It's the only one with closed eyes. They're not sure why. And these are in the little museum there. And again, you can see the clearly Negroid features. This has been, you know, analysed by lots of different people. And you can see the sort of cool, funky sort of 50s haircut as well on both of them. And this is in the museum there again, yet another Olmec head. And this is very interesting because it's got seven braids on the back. This has been analysed by some researchers in Western Africa, and they do exactly the same technique there that has been known about a few hundred BC. And so they're realizing there is a possible connection with this sort of style here. You see the great big kind of axe-like earring. And these are some of the mounds, although this was just in the museum, you can't go there anymore. These are some of the mounds around the back of near Trascepotes, which we're going to have a look at in a moment. And they were basically like a mound culture, a bit like North America and a bit like in Britain. And they used earth as their main building construction. But there is evidence they were using stone too in some places where they could. But because the Gulf Coast doesn't have a great deal of it, because of the tropical climate, they did use earth a lot, but a lot of it's obviously been destroyed now because of the very, very hot, humid tropical climate. I'll take questions at the end, if that's okay. And this is another Olmec head. This is actually in Trascepotes, and you can get a bus straight there from Santiago Tuxtla. It's not easy to get to these Olmec sites if you do travel in this part of Central America, but you can do it. And following on from Paul Devereaux's work yesterday, this is very interesting. Some of the stones in Trascepotes are acoustically built and designed. This is actually quite a big construction that kind of goes around like this. It's pretty big. It kind of goes, you know, it's probably about 10 feet wide in like a circular kind of hoop. Yeah, and this is where they meet again, but they've obviously cut it here because that's got a different tone to that one. I did record it on my camera, but I can't show you it here. And again, this is a very strange sort of anamorph figure. A lot of them have these square bits going off the back as though they were placed within walls. And this is, you get this at Tiwanaku in Bolivia, exactly the same kind of design and style. This is the famous Long Count calendar stone found at Trascepotes. This really, really annoyed the Mayanists when this was discovered. Back in the 1950s, and it's one of the earliest dates that have ever been recorded in the Mayan calendar. Before that, the earliest Mayan, before this was discovered, the earliest Mayan date was 228, the earliest Mayan date was about 100 or 120 AD. So when Matthew Sterling, the archaeologist, uncovered this in the 1950s and found a long count date, which goes back to 31 BC, the Mayanists and the academics went into shock, and they couldn't cope with the fact that all the research and academic books they'd written about the Mayans, saying it was the Mayan calendar and all this kind of stuff, had been completely destroyed in one fell swoop by Matthew Sterling and his discovery of this particular stone at Trascepotes, which has a 31 BC calendar date. I'm not going to have a chance to get thoroughly into this whole calendar issue here, but Jeff Stray is probably around and he can sort of fill you in on some of the details, and I can have a chat afterwards about the finer details of this. But there's been other calendar dates as well, which have been found on stones. This is just an analysis of that particular stone. This is what's on the other side of the stone, a very strange guy with a sort of chest thing he's wearing, and I can't really work out what the rest of it means. But in Chapa de Corzo, for instance, which is quite a bit further south, another cycle, so what's called cycle 7 dates, which is about 100 or so BC, which is here, and we're up there at the moment, but here, yet another calendar date has been found. And this has been analysed by Jeff Stray, and these are some of the dates he came up with. Now, if we're talking about the Olmecs, this date kind of fits, but because part of this stone's missing, we can't finalise and fix the date, which is just the nature of the way these dot and bar systems work. So these are the possible ones. That's the ones that the academics have gone for. This is the one I like. because it fits in with the Olmec period perfectly. And this is the kind of time they would have been developing the calendar. Because it's quite well known, so you're aware of this, that the long count or the 13 Bacton cycle calendar began in 3114 BC and ends in December the 21st, 2012. And so this intrigues me because there's not any known culture apart from possibly Quetzalcoatl and his people and Quilquilco that go anywhere near that date. And so who was around to start the calendar in 3114 BC? My money's on Quetzalcoatl, and he was the one who influenced the Olmecs when they turned up around 2000 BC, and then they developed the calendar that he'd started. Again, this is speculation. They could have, in some traditions in the Mayan calendar systems anyway, they backdate their calendars to cover epochs of time they want to have power or control over. Lots more to this than that. This is just a brief sort of plethora of ideas. But there's much older dates than that possibilities with this Chapa de Corzo one. So it's just interesting to note that although the Mayans developed the calendar and turned it into this hugely sophisticated masterwork of multiple calendars, it looks like the Olmecs were the ones who kind of, you know, got the first inkling of the date sorted out. They also had the Harb calendar, which is the 365-day solar year calendar. And there's evidence now that they even had the 260-day Zolkin count as well, which is the sacred calendar. But we can talk, have a little chat about that afterwards if anyone wants to get into numbers. This is another one, which is quite interesting, 156 AD. Although it's a bit later, it's yet another very early, one of the earlier dates of the calendar of La Majora. Anyway, so if we move slightly east from Tres Zapotes to San Lorenzo, this is one of the most important Olmec sites. There's not many left anyway, and most of the sites have been completely destroyed, apart from La Venta, which we'll have a look at shortly. This is one of the most recently discovered Olmec heads. It was discovered in the 1980s. It was actually found in a swamp, and someone got really freaked out when they were on their boat on the swamp when they saw this massive head looking at them, because it was facing upwards, and it's like, oh my God, what's that? And then this strange stone spheres as well. These are very similar to the ones you obviously find in Costa Rica and also in Bosnia, around the Great Pyramids in Bosnia too. There's some other carvings from San Lorenzo, this very strange sort of black basalt super rock on the right here. Mutilated faces on the left. The top right, we've got what looks like a Caucasian fella crouched and sort of hugging a stone. It's a bit like some of us doing Glastonbury quite frequently. And also we have these strange markings, and there was obviously some kind of stand they used there. But really unclear about what a lot of these were used for. But San Lorenzo, it's known because it was analysed by Matthew Stirling in the 1950s, but also John Burke more recently, the last 10 years. In the book Seed of Knowledge, Stone of Plenty, he did a superb analysis of this, and he found that there was lots and lots of stonework still left at San Lorenzo, but it's all been moved and destroyed pretty much now. And he believed that they had a whole aqueduct water system there, which enabled them to get water down from the mountain, and they could put water all over their crops. They had a thriving agricultural area there. And even he believed, his research, he analysed Earth energy scientifically, and he believed that they were using the charge from that movement of water through this stone to actually enhance their seeds and grains. When they then went and planted them, they would get a better yield. And this has been analysed thoroughly by Burke and Kaj Halberg in Seed of Knowledge, Stone of Plenty. And I'd just like to say that John Burke actually died this year, and I just want to sort of show my respects to him for his work that he's done. He was a brilliant author, and he was part of the BLT research team. And that Seed of Knowledge, Stone of Plenty book is one of the finest books I've ever read on anything to do with the Earth Mysteries subject. Highly recommend it. I then went up to Quetzalcoatl, which is, excuse that photo, I went up to Quetzalcoatl on the Gulf Coast. This is the most southern part of the Gulf Coast, in this area, kind of here. And this is where I only went. There's nothing left there. It's an oil town. The whole Gulf Coast is like a whole oil area. And this is actually the beach where Quetzalcoatl was said to have left the country. In some traditions, he spent 20 years in Mexico teaching all the different tribes and cultures, all these arts and sciences we've looked at. And then he got driven out by a dark god who wanted to bring back sacrificing and the old ways before Quetzalcoatl got there, because he was against sacrificing. It was one of his main agendas, was to remove that from the land. And so he was driven out. He was driven out by the dark god, and this is where he was said to have left. and Quetzalcoatl on a raft of serpents. And interestingly, Quetzalcoatl means serpent sanctuary. So this whole raft of serpents thing is very odd. This is the whole kind of serpent symbolism we're dealing with here. And there's a whole global prehistoric culture that used had this serpent symbolism involved with them, including, obviously, Viracocha in South America. So the next stop was La Venta, and this is supposed to be one of the later, slightly later Olmec capitals to San Lorenzo. This is the pyramid they built there, and you can see it's pretty big. It's bigger than Silbury Hill, for instance, if you want to get some kind of idea of that. This is the layout of the site, a very interesting layout. This is seven fluted cone pyramid here. It was all built up around a kind of swamp, so it was all surrounded by water like a moat. Very unusual mosaics discovered here and here and there. And there's megaliths. There was all this very strange. I went there twice to check this out, and it kind of blew me away. This is one of the, again, the sort of African-looking heads. This is very interesting. This really blew people away when this was discovered, because from 1600 BC, there's evidence of the wheel being used in Central America. It's only a toy. This is like looks like it's a kid's toy. On the top right there. And so it's evidence they knew about the concept of the wheel, even if they didn't actually use it themselves. It seems like they had some other high technology which enabled them to do their work. Again, this is in La Venta. These are two more heads. This is number 18 and 19 that have been discovered, but they're so mutilated and so battered that they're barely recognizable. Huge, great megalithic stone here. There's lots of these at La Venta and in the Olmec world. When you're in Jalapa Museum, for instance, they have the oldest sort of civilizations at the entrance end. So everything's massive. It's all Olmec. It's like huge megalithic stuff everywhere you look. As you walk down to the later eras, everything just gets gradually smaller until it gets tiny to about 600 years ago. And so you see that the high technology of moving these super huge stones was known, and it was gradually lost in this part of the world. Again, this is La Venta. These are just reconstructed heads made of fiberglass. This is the central plaza. This is all these columns. They've all been broken now. These are all basalt. These were moved from several miles away. And this is sort of how it was laid out, although they would have all been standing in a tight circle of columns, like a sort of, almost like sort of wood hinges, like the sort of tight timber circle, but with these basalt columns. A lot of the, most of La Venta, most of the stones and the heads were moved to a place called La Venta Park. This is where some of the mosaics were saved, some of the Olmecoid kind of figures were saved, and this is just a reconstruction of how strangely these mosaics were built very deep. It kind of looks like they're trying to build a swimming pool to me, but that might not be the case. And this just shows you on site the pyramid. It's a very wet and windy day, but I still did it. This is the strange kind of, again, we keep seeing this Egyptian looking stones everywhere you look. This is on the other side of the pyramid, another Olmec head, an altar back in the woods there. And La Venta seems to be, you know, on this great energy line as well, this rainbow serpent that also goes through Lake Titicaca. And obviously this is the extension of the Michael line that goes, they meet at Lake Titicaca. So this is La Venta Park. This is where a lot of the stones got moved to. My sort of similarities are ridiculous. This is an unfinished head. You can see some kind of technique of how they were constructing these things. This is a very strange kind of demonic looking feature. This is the smiley one that we saw earlier. This is a reconstructed one. La Venta Park's very interesting. It's in Villahermosa town, which is the main oil town on the Gulf Coast. It's definitely worth a look. They've got a zoo in there as well, if you like animals. Here's the flying man. He's quite famous. He kind of points at everyone. He's in quite a few different Olmec things. This is the sort of more Mayan-looking sort of figurine and headdress. Looks like he's being greeted by a bearded fellow here, carrying what looks like a rifle. So there's lots of strange carvings the more you look at these. This is what they used as tombs, these basalt columns to construct their tombs. This is one of the more battered Olmec heads. This has been compared to the face on the Sphinx by various people. If you look at the profile of this, it's remarkably similar. This is again a close-up of the Olmec kind of shaman emerging from the cave. You can see this here is actually the extension of this goddess's or woman's arm, which turns into a serpent, and it's like it's holding a serpent against the ground. And here we can see four serpents come in, from different places. So again, the serpent symbolism was very rife with the Olmecs. This is the one of the main Olmec heads at La Venta Park. It was obviously at La Venta site itself before it got moved in the 1950s. So we're going to move down from the Gulf Coast. You've had a quick Olmec kind of download there. I didn't get to Chapada de Corzo because there's nothing really left there. So we went down to Izapa via Palenque and a few other places. I was quite interested in this place because I'd read all the work of John Major Jenkins. And there seems to be a Mayan kind of Olmec crossover here where the Olmecs looked like they were kind of starting to teach the Mayans what they became famous for. This is just some phallic stone there. These are some of the amazing carvings. And here we keep getting this kind of serpent, or some people, there's lots of frog figurines as well we'll look at. Jenkins believes that a lot of these symbols that are on and carvings on the stones at Izapa show galactic alignment in 2012, and he's written several books about this. It's highly recommended. What interests me about this place is these sort of psilocybin mushrooms and these Bufo marinus toads. As Paul Devereux mentioned once or twice yesterday, they were obviously a highly psychedelic culture, so much so that they were carving them into stones. Psilocybin is the same stuff you get in the magic mushrooms in Britain. Bufo marinus toads, you get 5-MeO-DMT from their shoulders, and if you extract it in the correct way and smoke it, you have the most powerful psychedelic experience known on Earth. Not that I've done that, of course. And here is some of the beautiful stonework in the Izapa Museum, which is in the nearby town of Tapachula. And we moved into Guatemala, over the border, to the most dangerous town in Central America, but we didn't know that at the time. And this is a place called El Baul, and we had three guards. They didn't have guns on them, unfortunately, but we got away safe. And they took us to these sites, and this is El Baul. Again, you see this sort of very Phoenician, Egyptian-looking kind of stonework here. The dating on this is quite interesting. Officially, it's a few hundred BC, but there's a lot of evidence that it's much, much older because not much work has been done here. And in a sense, there's not much funding for archaeology in Guatemala unless it's Mayan, which is a little bit prejudiced to me. These are some of the stones out in a field called Bilbao, just not far from El Baul. These are just left in a sugarcane field. Apparently everyone on the street there carries guns if you go there, so be careful. And these are great big figurines. I've got a better photo of this that's in the museum. This was another one. When you see the carvings in a moment, you'll see there's really beautiful carvings on there. It's a stunning piece of work, very similar to some of the Olmec stuff. This is one that they just discovered the week before we got there. I don't know if we can claim anything on that, Jacqueline. That's obviously Jacqueline. But there's a face there, eye there, earlobe there, and there's a lot of other stuff going on. You can't see it clearly in that photo, but I'm sure that'll be excavated soon. This is another stone just out in the field at Bilbao. You can see the beautiful stonework. Again, quite unique, very Olmecoid. Here's some other strange faces here with tongues or something sticking out of their mouth. Again, great megaliths. Outside, this is just, they call it a finca, it's just a little museum, basically. You have to find the local guy with the key to get in, but we did that. Here we get the strange Olmecoid heads. This is all in the El Baul, Bilbao area, of great big megalithic chunks outside the church. And again, we get the psilocybin mushrooms and the little spheres. So we know that there was definitely some kind of psychedelic fun being had by that lot. Double serpent symbolism, this really interests me, especially with the earth energies research that I've been doing, and me and Sean have been working on over the years, and they're sort of coming together here. It's like an Ouroboros almost as well. This is a replica of the stone we just looked at, and you can see the detail of the stonework is rather incredible. And here's just another selection of the stones from the Bilbao small museum there. It's a fascinating place. There's so much of this kind of stuff in Central America, in the Gulf Coast, in southern Guatemala, Izapa, which is just in Mexico over the border from Guatemala. It's really worth spending a bit of time down that way and exploring. Be careful around this area, especially. And we then moved to a small town called La Democracia. These all came from a site that's now been destroyed called Monte Alto. And these are, again, Olmecoid heads, very strange-looking heads. And there's a few seated kind of Buddha figurines. But they seem to be wearing shades for some reason, or they're wearing some kind of spectacles. Definitely, they're definitely wearing something on their eyes. You can see that quite clearly. You can see the bit going across there. Yeah? I mean, that's very clear, and this is like several hundred BC officially, although we know that the other Olmec heads are 1,500 BC at least. But yeah, these are just in the main plaza at La Democracia. They're very big, you know, you can see the size of them. Strange seated Buddha type figures. There's quite a few of these in southern Guatemala. Not quite the same as the Olmec stuff. There's a whole different style and design to a lot of these rock carvings, but very megalithic nonetheless, as you can see by the sheer magnitude of them. And you can see the sort of intriguing look on his face. He looks very pleased about something. And even on the border into Honduras, just south of here, on our way to Copan, we found the Bufo marinus toad, you know, on a border, which is quite interesting. It's got DMT potentially on his shoulders. And also these strange lion figurines, which occur quite frequently at these South Guatemalan sites. There's quite a few of the, quite a few exact same, like, for example, there's two of these, and some of the statues, there's two of them. There's always one, there's always two, or sometimes even four of the same one. I did notice this in a few of the Southern Guatemalan sites. And this is something that I kept finding throughout Central America and all around the world, apparently. It just says, may peace prevail on earth, in four different different languages on each side. And there's a group going around the world planting these and cementing them in the ground, which is rather sweet, I think. So we had a quick look at Copan, but I'm not going to go into that here because it's not really potentially a megalithic site. There's some interesting carvings there. But I wanted to move on to Carigua, which is again in southern Guatemala, further east towards Belize. And here it's a very interesting site because we're looking at pretty much the hugest, biggest megaliths in the whole of Central America, even bigger than some of the Olmec stuff. And here, this is one of the strange anamorph figures, which is the present at the site. I've got this strange orb on my camera, which I hadn't had any orbs before this one. This is the first one that came. I don't use a standard camera, I use a video camera to take my shots. So I was very pleased that popped up. I'm not sure what that is or what it means. However, to me, I didn't know this. I've looked at lots of photos of Corrigo and I did a bit of research before I went there. However, look, there's three huge stones underneath it. Now, I don't know if this was originally like this. To me, if you were to remove the carving and put them stones in a slightly different configuration, you'd have a classic dolmen. Yeah, it's quite clearly you can see that. And there's several of these on site. So whether these were there much earlier, we don't know. Again here, this is another one, three huge stones underneath this zoomorph, anamorph figure. These are the largest stelae, the largest, tallest stones in Central America. Some of them are up to 36 or 37 feet tall. They're beautifully carved out of hard sandstone, quite worn now. And then at the back, I got a bit excited, as you can see in this photo, but at the back of the site there, I hadn't seen this in any photos. I'd only seen photos of the stelae and the zoomorph figures, or the anamorph figures. Got back there and suddenly I find this huge megalithic kind of construction, which is part of the whole kind of temple complex there. I found these sort of several, you know, probably 5 to 10 ton stones, perfectly cut, placed together. You can't fit a card between them. Similar style again to Egypt and South America. And again, you can see the polygonal walls even, the way they're placing these together in perfect configurations, and even strange toes coming out of them as well. Which I thought was very interesting. And as we move into central Belize, I think I've got the slides here for that, you find a very similar style at Lubantum and Nimli Punit. Lubantum is where the crystal skull was discovered. And when I was at Carigua, I had a chance meeting with this guy, and I kind of was asking him if he could give me a lift to Guatemala City, because otherwise I would have been stranded. And he basically let me stay at his family's home. And then he took me to his sort of garage area and pulled out all these artifacts that he'd found. And I was very pleasantly surprised. And interestingly, that looks particularly Olmec or Izarpan style. This is very interesting. And there's about 30 of these artifacts. I just took a photo of showing you the main ones here. And this one here, as we'll see, looks just like some of the larger stone heads that were found at a place called Abajtakalik, which is just over into Guatemala near the Mexico border at the south area. And some of his pendants and smaller pieces look particularly Olmec as well, which I found very interesting. The Guatemala City Museum, there's lots of interesting stuff there. This site here, Caminjua, if that's correct, but they date this in the museum at 2500 BC, so we're going even beyond the Olmec era when we're looking at southern Guatemala. So all this stuff we've looked at El Bao, Bilbao, and all these other sites could be 2,500 to 3,000 BC. And again, we get this, the psilocybin mushroom, we get the Bufo marinus toad, we get the dude with shades on, we get the seated Buddha figures, we get these beautiful carvings, really well done. Guatemala City Museum is awesome, and it's really worth checking it out if you're there, if you're interested in the Mayan stuff as well, of course. Either a strange crash helmet or a mushroom on his head. Again, strange eyepieces, the glasses, shades, seated figures, some of the stelae. There's so much stuff in this museum, you really have to explore it thoroughly yourself. I just wanted to show you some of the key pieces there relating to my research. And then this is just around this area, just over the border here. That's I think late Atitlan, around this area. That's the place, that's the sort of site near in Guatemala City where all these pieces were found. Here is a place called Abaxtacalik. It's a very, very hot day I was there. I can barely cope with the heat that day. I can barely cope with the cold here today. These are some strange chambers that I found there, and these look particularly sort of Irish or from Cornwall or even New England, showing megalithic kind of construction again. This is like the smoking gun of the Olmecs. This is yet another Olmec head, the only one that's been discovered that looks anywhere near like the ones on the Gulf Coast in further south than there. And this is down in southern Guatemala. You can clearly see the ear there. You can see the shape of the helmet. And the archaeologist guy, and there's a lips there, a nose there, not much left of it. But it might look thin to you, but most of the Olmec heads are quite thin if you look at it on profile. So this does fit in, and this is pretty much the same size as some of the smaller Olmec heads. So it's proof, it's like the smoking gun that the Olmecs were moving south. They were a diffusion going into the southern parts of Central America and possibly into Belize. It just shows you some of the other sort of strange stonework, again, heads. This is a larger stone that my chance meeting with that guy in Carigua. The small one he was holding is almost exact replica of this one, found in a similar area in southern Guatemala. Strange crocodile features at the base of some of the pyramids at Abaxtacalik, Stelae. Oh, I have got the Copan images in. I'll just have to flick through these ones swiftly. But this is a sort of, again, this is like the same kind of culture, but there's evidence here of Orientals even being here as well. And you do get some interesting megalithic stonework, like a sort of otherworldly seat. Very interesting carvings here and stones. Very powerful energy here as well, if you're sensitive to that kind of thing. And that plume serpent energy line we looked at earlier goes through this site too. Strange third eye carving on this Olmecoid head. And again, the beautiful stelae there, which are similar to those at Carigua. And there's actually quite a lot of battles, apparently, between Carigua and Copan around 700 AD. These are just some of the stones you get at some other sites. This is a place called Calakmul. Just wanted to show you the sheer size of some of the stelae here and the way the trees are hugging the stones, a bit like us Glastafarians do frequently. This is a place in Belize called Cerros. This is northern Belize. I just wanted to show you this because of the Olmec features on the stucco carvings here, the stucco kind of shapes and carvings, and also an Olmecoid pendant that was found there. So we can see that even right up to northern Belize, there's evidence of the Olmecs, or certainly they were inspired by it, or something along those lines. This is the guy called Jim that I met in northern Belize. He's an explorer. He's like a professional explorer, does it for a living. This is some wooden piece he found in the Mayan mountains, just near the Guatemala border with Belize. Here he is with Anna Mitchell Hedges. He used to live with her with the famous Mitchell Hedges crystal skull. And he's got the whole inside story on that, which I can let you know if you meet me outside. And again, in Belize, just further south of there, is a place called Lamanai. And this has just been uncovered, this one. And it's a clear Olmecoid head. And it's about the same size, but this is stucco, so it's been shaped and kind of, carved as such, just sort of pieced together with stucco like cement. This is just the pyramid that it was on. But again, we see the diffusion seems to be going throughout Central America. And so if we move further south, right down south in Belize, near a place called Punta Gorda, is the famous Luban tomb, where the Mitchell Hedges crystal skull was discovered. But what really interested me here was the whole polygonal stonework here, which Gary Biltcliffe's very into, and I wanted to show him these, but I don't think he's here today. And you can see here, and these are huge megalithic blocks. We're talking 5 to 15 tons here. This isn't the standard Mayan design. Similar to Quirigua as well, so we think there may have been some culture down there, several hundred, if not 1,000 BC. And we know that southern Guatemala, with that place near in Guatemala City, is 2,500 BC at least. So there's a lot to consider in that part of the world. Again, the crystal skulls that were discovered here. We have this strange spaceman with a crash helmet. It's just like about this big, tiny little piece. Boxing gloves, strange skirt. This guy here wearing the glasses again. So there's a lot of these things that really haven't been analysed, researched, or documented just yet. Nimli Punet is just down the road from Luban tomb. Again, it's hugely megalithic site. You get the largest stele in Belize. This one here is 35 foot tall. This is my Mayan friend who was showing me around. I stayed at his Mayan family's home, which is very pleasant. These are some of the megalithic blocks in the stairway. So we can see that there's clearly a megalithic culture going back throughout Central America. So I've just given you a brief outline of some of the places that we visited, and it just proves to me that there is something going on there that hasn't been looked at thoroughly. The only person I know who's done a good book about this is David Hatcher Childress. He's really covered it effectively about the Olmecs. But with the calendar evidence here and the evidence of perhaps that Quetzalcoatl was actually a person and not a legend, as most people think, suggests that this is definitely worth looking at again from a megalithic perspective. This is why I felt it was appropriate for me to stand in for Sean here and do this. And this is just, I'm just going to finish up here on time, which is good. This is the carving from Tikal that was actually that's in the northern highlands of Guatemala, which is one of my favourite places on earth. And this is a carving that was removed in the 1930s and taken to the Berlin Museum. And it's one of the only pieces of evidence that there was some kind of ancient destruction in antiquity. And this is what a lot of people believe Quetzalcoatl and Viracocha and all these other groups of these so-called white gods came from. That they came to this land from another place because their land got destroyed. And this was the only evidence in stone of that kind of thing happening. The problem is this actually got ironically destroyed itself in the Berlin Museum when it was bombed in the Second World War. So it's quite unfortunate, but at least there's photographs and illustrations of it. And with 2012 fast approaching, it really is good from my perspective, from the ancestors and the ancient perspective, to know where we've come from, especially as the Mayan calendar or the Olmec calendar ends on December the 21st, 2012. It's worth having another look at what they were doing back then, so we get some idea of what we were doing back then, so we have an understanding of who we are now. And on the other hand, it could be just as simple as this. So thank you very much. Cheers.